Okay, well, welcome everyone to the 2022 Beautiful Scotland and It's Your Neighbourhood Seminar and Celebrations. And for those of you who don't know me, I'm Juliet, who leads on our Beautiful Scotland and It's Your Neighbourhood programmes. And it just, although it's sad not to be in person, it's just fantastic to have everyone here today. And we've got a really exciting day ahead. I'll just move on to the agenda now. But we're going to start by a welcome from Chair of our Charity Trustees, Tom. And then we've got a couple of highlights from a Beautiful Scotland group and an It's Your Neighbourhood group. And we'll move on to some Year of Stories case studies. And then we've got two fascinating presentations from a couple of external speakers. We're then going to showcase some more of your inspiring activities. Then we'll have a Q&A session before a comfort break, when we'll show the photo loop of all your showcase images. And then we'll all come back together again for a bit of a drinks reception, a few words from one of our assessors, and then we'll move on to the award ceremony. Like I said, we are going to be showing a few videos. So just play around with your sound and hopefully you'll be able to hear each one properly. And I think without further ado, I'll hand you over to Tom.
Okay, thanks, Juliet. Hi, everyone, and welcome to this year's It's Your Neighbourhood and Beautiful Scotland Award ceremony and celebration. And it is very much a celebration. It's about recognising and celebrating everything that you've all achieved in and for your communities right across the country throughout the year. So, as Juliet said, we'll have our award ceremony at the end of the afternoon. But as far as I'm concerned, you're all winners, because what you're achieving in your communities is quite remarkable and has so many benefits. For example, because of your hard work, villages, towns and cities right throughout Scotland look so much better. Something that I know is really appreciated by both locals and visitors. But there are so many other benefits as well from the work that you're doing, including health and well-being, community pride, tourism, and I think very importantly and very topically, increasing biodiversity. And we actually moved the timing of this seminar to this week to coincide with the COP Biodiversity Conference, which is happening just now in Montreal, because we wanted to highlight the importance of biodiversity and the work that all our community groups throughout Scotland are doing in this vital area. So to try and get that message out to a much bigger audience, what we're going to do is we'll be issuing press releases about this biodiversity work and posting on social media. So please like and repost if you see any of our social media out there at all. That would be great if you can spread the word. That would be much appreciated. We're also featuring a blog on our website this week, focusing on practical advice for improving biodiversity. And that's written by one of our volunteer Beautiful Scotland judges, Stan DePrato. And I saw Stan earlier. So thank you very much, Stan, for doing that. And so I'd recommend anybody going onto the website and having a read of that. It'll be very useful advice. So all of your Beautiful Scotland and It's Your Neighbourhood activity, no matter how small, helps towards reducing the climate and nature emergencies, because you're coming together and working collectively to make a real difference. So whether it's because you're reducing carbon footprint through food growing and encouraging others to eat local veg, making compost, collecting rainwater, using solar power, seed saving, seed sharing, recycling and reusing, promoting active travel, or helping biodiversity through planting trees, creating wildflower meadows, managing green spaces in nature-friendly ways, supporting wildlife habitats and pollinators, or educating and inspiring your communities and the next generation. Now, that's quite a list, very impressive. So just, we're so grateful for everything you do, and in so many ways. That's just some of the things that I know that you do. And it does make a difference. So thank you very much for everything that you do. And I think one of the great things about It's Your Neighbourhood and Beautiful Scotland is that you and every community group is part of a really extensive national network of community groups with amazing knowledge, skills, enthusiasm and experience, which people are so willing to share for the benefit of all. And today is very much part of that. So we're going to be hearing from wonderful, inspiring case studies from community groups right around the country. And it's something I would encourage in terms of getting in touch with other groups or visiting other groups, because I think the more we can share thoughts, ideas, experiences, then so much the better, and it benefits everyone and it benefits communities right around the country. So it's about not being just a community group on your own. I think that It's Your Neighbourhood and Beautiful Scotland is all about being part of that invaluable network. We're part of a big family, I think. That's the way I like to think about it. So in addition to all that, and hearing from the local case studies, I'm delighted that we have three external speakers joining us today. Kevin Frediana from Dundee Botanic Gardens, Anthony McCluskey, who's the chair of the Garden for Life Forum, and Jim Jeffrey from Nature Scott. And we look forward to hearing from all of them later on. So finally, I just would like to say, I hope that you have a fun and enjoyable, inspiring and informative afternoon. And just to say thanks again for everything that you do to help keep Scotland beautiful and benefiting Scotland's places, people and wildlife. It is hugely appreciated. So thank you for everything that you do. But now it's about sharing your inspiring stories and celebrating your achievements. So with that, I'll hand you back to Juliet. Thanks, Juliet.
Thank you, Tom. Okay, so rather than listen to me, like I said earlier, we wanted to showcase what you've been doing. And so we've picked one Beautiful Scotland group and one It's Your Neighbourhood group to come and share their stories. So first, I'd like to welcome Wendy Murray from East Haven Together in Angus, who were a joint overall winner of our Premier Beautiful Scotland Award this year. So are you there, Wendy?
I am. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Great. Okay, well, hello, everybody. And really pleased to be with you and share today with you. We've had a lovely year in East Haven and we made this video because we wanted everybody to know how much fun we've had in the process. So we made huge efforts to involve the wider community and we've been really inspired by the work carried out across all the other Beautiful Scotland and It's Your Neighbourhood groups too. So for us in East Haven, Keep Scotland Beautiful is very much about the way that we all work together right across Scotland to achieve change and make a difference in our communities. As you'll see in the video, we've really tried to push forward the three pillars this year. And I have to say that we've really enjoyed every minute of it. So here we go.
Thank you, Wendy, and everyone at East Haven. That's amazing video, and apologies, the quality wasn't the best, but I can send the link round to everyone to watch. So thank you so much. I know a lot of people saw this at the award ceremony as well, but it'd been updated and we thought it was worth sharing so more people could see what you've been getting up to. So thank you for sharing. Okay, next we have two short videos from St Francis RC Primary School in Dundee. The first video introduces the project and the second video will hopefully make you all smile. The patch is the school's allotment garden at Murrayfield Allotments in Whitfield, Dundee. It continues to flourish year on year and provides a fun, safe and relaxing space for pupils and their families to enjoy. It includes a bird hide and outdoor classroom where children can learn about wildlife and vegetable plots for growing food. This year's harvest has included potatoes, strawberries and rhubarb. So on to the introduction to the patch.
Video from St. Francis.
We love our allotment and we'd like you to love it too. Bye!
Video from...
Okay, and now the second video. So I love that video. I thought it was great to see how much joy the children get out of gardening and learning about wildlife. So thank you to everyone at the patch for sharing that video with us. So now we're on to our year of stories case studies. And we've been delighted to see how much you've engaged with our optional theme this year. And thanks for those of you who sent in your stories for the public vote. Hopefully you all got the email I sent out on Tuesday so that you can vote for your top three. And I'm I've been inundated with emails already, so it's been brilliant. And yep, the deadline for voting for your favourites is next Tuesday at 5 p.m. and we'll reveal the winner at the online Christmas social and quiz on Tuesday evening. Today, though, we wanted to share three group stories with you. So first up, we have Norma Smith from Kinneswood in Bloom. Norma, hello. Are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Brilliant. Over okay. to you.
Welcome to Kinneswood. It's rather sunny, but a little bit chilly today. We wrote a book a few years ago called A Walk Through Kinneswood, and that told the history of the old village. We still have, I think, probably a few hundred copies left. So we put it in the bus shelter, and folk can pick it up for £1, which they do in an honesty box. And that's been a good fundraiser for us. The pupils of Port Moat, not to be outdone, they then wrote their own book about Michael Bruce, who's a local poet, and it's a beautiful book, and that one's available as well. The other feature that tells stories about the village is a lovely tiled panel. This was made long before I joined the group, and it's in the picture garden beside the shop, and you can't see it close up there, but it does tell lots of stories about the village. So we were really into storytelling. Anyway, the next one. It fitted perfectly with what we would like to do. We've got a number of little figures. We used to have 18 because we got the money to do them for when the Ryder Cup was on in 2014. And each year since then, we kept about 10 of them. And we cut off the golf clubs, and we've changed their arms in different positions, but we dress them up every year. Last year we had a mermaid and a pirate for the theme last year, but this year it was all about stories, and they all have a link to Kinneswood. So six were dressed over the winter by local craft ladies. They used lots of skills. They had sewing, crochet, belting and drawing. The figures are placed at appropriate places around the village, and they have a small interpretation board panel set in a post beside them. The children do the writing about these figures, and they're very involved in doing research and so on. Next one. So dressing the figures was a fun activity to do when you couldn't get out much. Two of our crafters have been shielding during COVID, and they were very glad to have a project to be involved in. The lady on the right, Margaret, suffers from COPD, and she really did shelter, although she's beginning to get out now. But she made these wonderful bees. The other lady, Gillian, is a champion at doing artwork with the children in school, but she also did the faces. And before this, our faces used to be a couple of buttons and a felt mouse, but we had real faces this year, which was lovely. And they did last. I mean, they got a little bit dirty with the weather and dust and so on, but the faces did last throughout the season. Okay, next one. We chose a Bronze Age lady carrying a funeral urn. Some of these urns have been discovered just beside the village in the last few years. And we chose Mary Queen of Scots, who was imprisoned in Lochleven Castle. We had a monk from St. Serf's Island. The monks produced vellum for many years, and then they passed on the knowledge of making vellum to a family in the village. The other three were Alexander Buchan, who was a meteorologist, and after whom Buchan's spells were named. We had Michael Bruce, the poet, and Eve Muirhead. She had a little bit of connection because she came from the area and was in primary one at the school before she moved elsewhere. So when she got her medal, we were very pleased to add that to her as well. The school were involved in doing artwork and doing the research based on these characters. We had to do the planning for this with the teachers by email at first, but by the end of term, we were allowed back into the school. The artwork was mounted in basic frames, and it was displayed in the hall as part of the Port Moat Festival. Many people visited the hall during the cream teas, and our famous pudding club. So lots of people saw the pictures. Next one. As you can see, we've had trails around the village before, but now we use modern technology and QR codes to tell the stories. So that people can either print out the map at home or they can just look on their mobile phone. There's other points where people can learn the history of the village. We have three interpretation boards so far telling the story of carts in the area. They can learn more about Michael Bruce, the poet. And there's also one about the landscape and where the urns were found and the history of that. And they've all been funded by Knesswood and Bloom. We do have someone in our group who's very able to do woodwork, and he made the stands for the boards to sit on. So that cut down our costs a bit. The last one. We're very fortunate to have a resident local historian, geographer, and he greatly helped us with the research. He's been working with one class in the school, finding out stories based in the cobbles, a historical street. And they've produced their own QR code trail with voices and music. So that was one of the classes in the school did that themselves. As a group, Knesswood and Bloom maintains the Michael Bruce Cottage Garden situated beside the museum. And at the moment, we're probably getting involved in fundraising because it's definitely needing a new roof. We love telling stories and we especially like cake. And you can see on the right that we managed to get a cake topper printed with our Year of Stories logo on it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Norma. We always love seeing how creative your community is and what you come up with each year. And it's wonderful to see and hear about all the different ages getting involved, and especially the link and relationship you have with the school. Like, it's really inspiring. So thank you for sharing. Okay, next up we have Candy from Keeping Duns Blooming Marvellous. Candy, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Great. Over to you.
Thank you. In 2019, a raised bed known as Barn End in Duns was overgrown and unsightly and had been untended for a number of years. It was primarily full of hypericum, with ivy, nettles, brambles, self-seeded ash saplings and other weeds growing through. There were also two large flowering cherry trees, which were stunning in the spring. This bed was beside two other untended areas, and apart from being a great hide for birds, was not an attractive entrance to the market square. In early 2019, I approached Scottish Borders Council and suggested we take over these beds after they had informed all gardening groups in the Borders that they were cutting back on gardening. The one stipulation they had was that the hypericum would be kept. So we decided to make the bed into a more wild area and concentrate on pollinators and a natural style of planting with hellebore, foxglove, geranium and other plants which thrive on slight neglect. We removed as much as we were allowed and drastically cut back the hypericum so we could see how to progress. And we added a small hedge of lavender along the front to attract bees and give the bed a little bit of detail. We also put a bird box in each tree to encourage nesting. In spring 2020, we noticed the left-hand cherry did not flower at all. And after speaking to neighbours of the bed, we were told it was quite poor the year before compared to previous years. It was agreed that someone from the council would come and take it down. I also suggested turning the tree into something, and the idea of the green man came about. However, before anything could happen, Storm Arwen hit. Luckily, no one was hurt and the damage was contained to the bed. Picture two, yep. I approached a local sculptor, Kevin, and with his help got the broken, very rotten tree trunk cut out and moved. The council thankfully removed the rest. Kevin did a lovely job carving a small owl, which will go to a sensory garden when it has been completed. I then had the idea of combining the work with the girl guiding group. The leader is also one of our garden volunteers. And so with her involvement, the children set out to make a den in the middle of the hypericum, which was now back up to full size, with stepping stones through to a little bug den and drinking pond. One of the leaders made the amazing finger post depicting the trails in the Gruffalo story, and the children painted stones with all the various bugs and animals they thought fitted the area. We had managed to get the original rotten trunk replaced with a holly, which was another casualty of Arwen, and Kevin set to carving out the green man with the owl, mouse, snake, and even a fairy door. It was lifted in place in June 22. I applied for a small schemes payment from the council and was granted the £600 Kevin had invoiced for his work. I then applied for £250 from Action Earth to cover the cost of the design of the interpretation board, which explains the mythology of the green man and also teaches about the different bugs we find in our gardens, both good and bad. More information for these topics is accessed by QR codes and smartphones. We had an official opening of the bed with all the girl guiding groups, parents, volunteers, plus Mark Rowley, our local councillor, designer of the interpretation board, Neil Watson, and the sculptor, Kevin Brack, also joined us.
You have time, Candy, to carry
on. Thank you. I'd like to read this little story. Our head judge, Lorraine Turnbull, unknown to us, had submitted our little story made into a delightful story. And I've got this here now. This is the story of a large cherry tree that had nestled in a neglected spot at the edge of a beautiful village. It was sad and lonely. No one ever came to see it and admire its strength. One stormy night, Arwen, the wicked wind who hated trees, blew through the village and felled this once mighty tree. The villagers awoke to find the devastation that Arwen had caused, and although sad, they decided to reawaken the green man, spirit of the tree, to create a fairy tale landscape for children to enjoy where once the cherry tree had stood. The green man, who was also the keeper of the environment, would protect the site and make sure that the evil Arwen would not return. A local woodsman set about carving the cherry tree trunk into a fantastic imaginary world with storybook characters and fairy doors overseen by a wise owl. However, in his hard work to create this masterpiece, he discovered that the cherry wood was not strong enough as it had been sick for a long time. He tried hard, but was only able to carve the wise owl. Luckily, an old and gnarled forester happened by with a young and straight sacred ilex, which was also a casualty of Arwen. The woodsman jumped for joy when he realized he could at last create his masterpiece and make the villagers and their children happy again. The villagers were indeed very happy to have this marvelous replacement for their old cherry tree, so happy in fact, that they decided to create a wonderful wildlife haven around their sacred holy sculpture. Children from the local girl guiding group painted stone charms to place where the cherry tree had once stood, and created a small pond for real wildlife and wrote about the magical creatures that could be found. The gruffalo and his friends, the snake, the mouse, the owl and the fox also made an appearance, although it remains to be seen whether they are real or not and whether they do in fact inhabit this spot. The villagers helped children to protect and care for the area, and they made a storyboard telling visitors the tale of the spot and how the good forces of biodiversity and community spirit overcame the threats of Arwen. And so, safe in the knowledge that the green man was forever watching over them, the owl and his friends lived happily ever after. Thank you.
Thank you, Candy. And I've got emotional now listening to you read that.
I know. Lorraine did such a good job with that.
It's wonderful, yeah. And sadly, Lorraine can't join us today, but you've done her proud, I think, reading out her story. So thank you for sharing the story of
we are planning to get this printed up on a board and put in the bed for everyone to read. So the part of the story.
We'll let Lorraine know that as well. Thank you. Good.
Thank you.
Okay, our last Year of Stories case study comes from the winner of our Year of Stories Beautiful Scotland Discretionary Award, which was a one-off award for this year. So over to you, Sandy and Alistair. Are you there? You might have to unmute yourselves.
Yeah, good afternoon. I'm Sandy Ingalls from Mearns Writers. This initially was a an approach by John Cruikshank to Mayor's writers to provide stories and poems, etc., for the Scotland Year of Stories, and it developed from there into a planned walk around Stonehaven with stops indicated at various places so that people could listen to the stories that Mayor's writers had provided. There's stories, there's poems, there's even a song that's been written by the members of the group. For the pamphlet itself, that was locally funded and basically created by one of Mayor's writers' members. She did the layout and the graphics. Elaine Lawson did an excellent job, did the lion's share of the work on the pamphlet. And during the time of the setting up of the walk, we had an interesting, happy sort of occurrence, because there was a discovery of one of Stonehaven's older worthies, a Victorian botanist, self-taught botanist, who lived and did much of his work in Stonehaven. But at the moment, we can actually speak to the man himself. So, John Duncan, are you there?
Hi, Luna. I'm fit like.
No, but I'd fit like yourself.
I'm all right. Fair to Midland. My name's John Duncan, and I was born in Bonny Toonestine Hive in 1794. And all my education came for Una Bootstein Hive. But Ned Squeal, I didn't bother muckle with that. It came for the parks and braes and glens and streams that I roamed about as a burden, for I learnt my love of nature. It's incredibly difficult to keep a top hat on when you're wearing headphones. John Duncan was an amateur botanist at a time when most amateur botanists, well, all amateur botanists, were men of means, gentry, ministers and the like. Yet John was a poor weaver man all his life. He would get up at 3-4 in the morning to do his weaving work, to allow himself time to go out and collect these plant specimens. And by the time he died, he had an entire collection of all plant life in Scotland and most plant life in Britain. He left at Aberdeen University. Poor he was all his life. In his 70s, he ended up having to go in the parish when he became unfit for work. And one of his gentrified botanist friends raised a public subscription for him, which raised the then astonishing sum of £300. I mean, it took him nearly 8 months to collect enough money together to buy a book that cost less than £1 early on in his career. Queen Victoria contributed a tenner to it. The Duke of Argyll did, and perhaps best of all, Charles Darwin contributed to it and sent him a letter addressed to my fellow botanist. Most of that money, when he died, was still there and was left in his will by him for the promotion of natural history to children in school. I'll leave that in his own words. I need to put the bonnet on again. I reckon that Bernie should be teaching about natural history. For the very first time that an infant exercises its feet upon a girth or stretches its arms in the open air, it's to chase butterflies or to poo wild flowers. That love of nature inspired John Duncan. I'd like to thank John Cruikshank for allowing us to be part of this project. I'd like to thank Keep Scotland Beautiful for inspiring a love of nature throughout Scotland, throughout its population. I'd like to thank Mearns Writers for celebrating the natural beauties that surround Stonehaven in the skills of their verse. But most of all, I'd like to thank the project for allowing to bring out of obscurity a man who should be remembered for his inspiration and love of nature, something that I think inspires us all. If you want to see more, the links that are on screen will take you to the recordings, and I hope you enjoy them. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Sandy and Alistair, for coming along and representing Stonehaven and the Muirns writers today. And thank you, John, for coming out of the history and attending today. See why the Year Group won the Year of Stories Discretionary Award this year. I'm delighted you
could join us. Get off, I welcome.
I think we'll all now want to visit Kineswood, Duns and Stonehaven to come and see your inspiring project. So thank you all for that. Next up, I'm very pleased to welcome our first external speaker, Kevin Frediani, who is curator at Dundee Botanic Gardens, to share some of the recent work they've been doing out in the community. So, Kevin, are you there?
I am, thank you. And Juliet, would you move the slides through when I...
I will, yes.
Yeah, so I'll mention it. Yeah, so just to begin with, thank you very much, Juliet, for inviting me today. And thank you to all of you that not only form part of Keep Scotland Beautiful, but make our cities, our urban areas around this beautiful country that much more sustainable and livable.
Why is this not sounding?
Jim and Wendy, I think you've got your... You're still speaking to us, I'm afraid.
I'll put you on mute, Jim and Wendy, don't worry.
In terms of the talk, what I'm going to do is just ask Juliet to flick through to the next slide to give you an overview. I'm going to try to introduce you to this thing called nature-based solutions in the context of the Botanic Garden and the work we're bringing across the city. It's a prototype project, but it's just gained traction as an opportunity for us to engage with others across Europe, which I'll give you an overview to as well as part of the project. But let's come back to where I am at the moment, sitting in this beautiful botanic garden that was began in 1971. So Juliet, the next slide shows the map of where we are, both in Dundee, but also in the west side of the city. There's 27 acres here, if you come to enjoy it. It's very different in terms of a landscape, not a normal order bed of plants A to Z, like going to a zoo. They're laid out ecologically, and I'll explain a little bit more about that later on. Next slide, please. So when the Botanic Garden was founded, there was a really nice article written by Hugh Ingram, which is captured in our very first and only guidebook to date. Juliet, if you click it, we'll be able to read, because it says that the taxonomic basis of most collections that you see in botanic gardens around the world was never part of this garden. Well, that's an interesting start, isn't it? So what makes it so different? Next slide, please. Well, botanic gardens, if you look at them around the world, and I've worked in a few. This is De Hortus Botanicus in Amsterdam, and it's one of the world's oldest botanic gardens. And what you'll find there are plant collections that have been gained over the years since the Italian Renaissance, really, and the scientific revolution that came thereafter. Initially to help provide a basis to medicine, later on an inquiry into the plant science, where they're found and where they grow. So we've got this history and cultural aspect to it. They've become a much a beautiful and valued part of the city, where we use education and increasingly talk about conservation and sustainability. In the most recent times, we've also got green health and well-being become part of that mix. And this ecosystem services, which seems to be quite a complex form of words when we sort of hear it for the first time. But basically, it's the benefits that we get from nature that support our lives on Earth today. Next slide, please. The sort of putting a place into what I do as a curator in a botanic garden, there's not many of us in the country, less than 60. It's quite a rare profession, really, when you look at it that way. There's no course you can go on. So we learn from each other. And most of us come from either a botanical background, like I have, Many of them follow taxonomic routes, but remember, this one's ecological. And I've got a background in human ecology and conservation as much as plant science. And I've even worked in zoos. And actually, in terms of thinking critically about curatorial roles, it was this guy on the left, Bill Conway, that reminded me when he wrote a paper that I found when I first curated London and Whipsnade zoos. And he wrote it to zoo people saying, why should we invest in exotic projects, gorillas from the Congo or chimpanzees, in these places where they're not meant to be, if we can't exhibit our own wildlife on our doorstep? And that's always been at the basis of the way that I thought about curatorial ways of working.
Botanical garden.
Thank you, Juliet. In terms of the focus for today, so, I mean, he wrote that paper in 1967, and he was thinking then about conservation, but we've got this other huge challenge facing us. There's a big division between people and the world, where we see resources taken, used to make things that we then throw away, and that becomes pollution. And we all know that there are problems both in our water, in our air, and in our soil. There's another divide, though, which sees big divisions coming through between us and other people, and that's mostly played out in the politics of the world. You only have to look at the divisions, deep divisions, that are coming through in the politics over Brexit, over America with Trump, and that whole aspect that's bubbling through of the underlying malaise, but also most prominently in Russia and Ukraine. And with the thing that we can think of somebody else that is not our kin and not our friend as other and kill them, for me, is just something I can't understand. But the impact of that is not just maintained over there in some other country. We see it impacting our food and our security and our fuel poverty in this country. And then we've got the other divide, which I'll pick up on, which is a spiritual divide, you know, between ourselves and ourselves. You know, the fact that if you look at the biggest killer of under 30-year-olds in the world today, under WHO, it's suicide. There's something wrong when people haven't got hope. And a lot of that is born through a sort of a disenchantment with a life not being well lived, which is unfortunate. And that's something that is beyond the realms of what the botanic garden can do. But there are things where we can intervene using plants and improving our environments to create better places for people to live. So this is a story about how spaces become places through the actions and reactions of people using plants and growing an environment that works for all of us. So next slide, please. In terms of nature-based solutions, for those of you that don't know what they are, very simply, I'll break them down into the sort of green infrastructure, anything green and living that you find within the city that supports wildlife, provides structure from our urban forests, street trees and parkland trees, right the way through to that encapsulated nature that you find there. And I'll show a picture in a minute, but they're the plants that provide benefits these ecosystem services. And the definition that I share with you there, you can read at your own leisure, but IUCN recognize this as a valid way of supporting cities. Indeed, they see that nature-based solutions and our green and blue infrastructure are at the very heart of our society going forward to learn how to adapt and mitigate the environments we live in to become resilient to climate change. And adaptation involves modifying our decisions and our activities and ways of thinking to adjust to climate change. Well, that's sort of saying that it's coming and we have to do something about it. The species we select and where we grow them, how they hold up the water further upstream. And then there's mitigation to the aims to reduce the causes of climate change. And of course, tree planting to absorb carbon dioxide, or meadow making to increase the amount of carbon stored in the ground are good examples of that. Next slide, please. So here's some examples of nature-based solutions that are being applied around the world. On the left, the bottom there, we've got just a box. It could be a bus shelter, it could be a subway, but it happens to have a green wall and a living roof on it. At the next up, we've got the reed beds. The longest reed beds in the UK are found just up the river from me, between here and Perth, between Dundee and Perth. We've got 8 miles of reed beds, and that habitat is encapsulated in nature between those two areas that we use, the land and the sea. We've got a road verge on the right-hand side at the top, which has been turned into a swale to capture the seasonal episodic rain that otherwise would go into storm water drains and then downstream and cause flooding or perturbations. And then there's a picture below to talk about the urban forest, just showing trees grow in private gardens, in parks, they're in linear belts, but they're collectively, they form this greater than the sum of their parts. Next slide, please. There are multiple benefits from trees, and I'm not here to talk to you about them, and that's I'll leave that for another day. But in terms of thinking about how we will bring those benefits into an evidence base that we can use on our own sites and share with our visitors, but also learn from and apply at a bigger scale at the university campus, and then share that evidence base, that cost, the learnings with the city of Dundee and then beyond into Scotland, is what the Living Lab has become at the University of Dundee Botanic Garden. It's got a base, it's in the first zero carbon building that was built in Scotland. And it was itself a living lab for our students of architecture and engineering, trying to work out how they could have a low carbon living off grid, what that would look like. And it's here, it's our library, if any of you come to see that. So the Living Lab using nature-based solutions will help conserve biodiversity locally and nationally. It will engage public and professionals in the work that we're doing and result in sustainable land use. So how are we doing that? Next slide, please. Well, at the heart of the garden, when it was first found in 1971, was established the 8 tayside habitats that go through the sand dunes that you find at Brottie Ferry right up to the top of the Angus Glens. And that landscape, 50 years on, provides a wonderful example of restoration ecology that we can bring back into the urban centres that's otherwise been displaced. 50 years ago, this was a potato field. Today, it looks like that picture on the right-hand side there. Next slide, please. We've also been adding to that. So we were building a new shelter and a gallery, an art gallery, so that the emotional connection through material could be made between the world that we see and enjoy and is a place of inspiration for artists, and through them connect back with our visitors about the fragility of that and how we can do better work. So we've created a place with a green roof, and we've gone through the planning on that and showed how it will work. We've also put in a rain garden in the Botanic Garden. Next slide, please. The other thing we've done is evidenced it. So we've actually looked at all of the trees and growing structures, which are, you know, plants, herbaceous plants, shrubs, but also the grass, and collected them using an iTree eco audit. And we know that this garden, 50 years on, has added £1.1 million of structural value to the property values around our site. We use a CAVAT. It's a model that's allowed in local government. It's been evidenced in court, so we know that that's got a robust figure. We've captured £23,000 worth of CO2 in the trees, and we sequester £441. But this is the beginning of a curve that will go up exponentially as these trees mature. Remember, they're only 50 years old. And some of them have the potential to live for up to 2,000 years, if you think about the giant redwoods. And 80 kilograms of ozone pollution is removed each year. That's only some of the figures. We've got PPM2s, PPM10s. These are the particles that come from the pollution of our diesel engines and from the brakes of our electric cars. But we've also got the amount of water that's been displaced. And we're using that to help us inform which trees, which plants, which types of plantings we can use to inform our future landscape. Next slide, please. We've taken that over the garden wall, and that was the original title of this talk, because this work isn't any good if it's only just on display in a captive environment like a botanic garden. And what we've done is created a partnership with people like Bunny Dundee, and I could see some of them here today. And through them and their connections and their sites, we've been looking at how we can grow plants that they can then grow on and share, and that help bring pollinators into our urban environments to change the way that we maintain our grasslands, to help them rewild into meadows again. And on the right, the picture there is the two Miyawaki wee forests that we created in the Botanic Garden last year, which was the beginning of these rapid interventions together with primary schools and with medical practices, looking at how nearby nature could enrich the quality of life and mitigate for some of the impacts of urban living today. They've been successful, and we're hoping to hear shortly whether we get funding to do another 16 across the city over the next 2 years, which would be amazing as for us to not only explore, but also to help engage with people across the city. Next slide, please. We've also been modifying the way we think about our own campus as a place of well-being for our staff and students, as a place of inspiration for our visitors, and as a home for wildlife. And we've come up with the concept of a well-being green campus, and that will be the focus over the next 10 to 12 years, which is the time I've got left before I retire and hand over, to take something that's very hard architecture that's shared with prisons and hospitals and zoos, and soften it. These institutions don't build for human well-being, but we should be, and we can do that and soften that with green walls, living roofs, swales, urban forests. And those are the type of infrastructure we'll be investing in over the next 10 years. Next slide, please. But Dundee has a wonderful green space. Those of you who know it might not know that there's more green space per capita here than any other city in Scotland. And that green space is vast, but not diverse. And what we've been trying to do with the city is look at how we could inform that. And we've gone into partnership together with 5 other cities across Europe. And it's a little bit premature because the announcement won't come out until next January. But we have got a collaborative which will involve 38 research institutions and allow us to set up the first city observatory that will help bring an evidence base of how nature-based solutions can improve an urban environment in the UK. And that's going to be 4 years long. So I'm going to tell you lots of stories over that in the years to come. And I think if you invite me back in 4 years' time, I'll tell you what we found and how the citizens of Dundee can vote on it to help them improve their own city to be more sustainable for the climate change that's being best predicted. And we've even signed up with Copernicus and Geos data from satellites that we'll be using to help us understand the impacts on those landscapes and how we can build resilience into them. A very exciting project. We've also got Eden Project coming, and they're partners to that, along with the City Council and many of the groups that have run across the city that are involved in green and blue infrastructure that I've mentioned before, like Bonnie Dundee. So there are many people behind this work. We're thinking globally, but we're trying to act locally. It's not my project alone, but I'm happy to front it and later on to answer any questions about it. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much, Kevin, for giving up your time today and sharing what the Botanics are getting up to. It sounds so exciting, and it fits very well with our theme for next year, which is health and well-being. So we might have to have you back. So thank you very, very much. Okay, hopefully we have Anthony now from Garden for Life Forum. Anthony, are you there?
Yep, I'm here, Julia.
Fantastic. I'll just move the slide on. Over to you.
Thanks. And it's great to hear that Kevin in Dundee is doing so much around rewilding the city. And actually, that's what I'm about to talk about today, too. So I happen to be chair of the Garden for Life Forum, as well as working for Butterfly Conservation as the Wild Spaces Project Officer. Next slide. Yeah, and just to introduce the forum, this is a partnership of organisations across Scotland. We work with biodiversity, food growing and gardening. So there are people like Butterfly Conservation, Plant Life, Bug Life, as well as Trellis, Scottish Allotments and Garden Society. So quite a mixed bunch, but we all come together to talk about these themes that we are associated with. And this is supported by Keep Scotland Beautiful. Next slide, Julia. And we have a lot of resources which are mostly hosted online. There are printed versions of these, but really the best place for you to find them is to go online. This is just a list of the ones that you can access if you go onto the webpage, and I'll show you the webpage soon. So it's everything from birds down to butterflies, how to have an orchard full of biodiversity, gardening without peat, bumblebees, and bedding plants for pollinators, dragonflies, everything that you could want in trying to make your garden and green spaces better for wildlife. Next slide, Julia. This is just an example of one of the leaflets. So here you see this is the bedding plants for pollinators one, something which I think many of you will be interested in, especially as you're trying to make your communities better for to look better and to win those prizes like the various awards that go on. So you want to have bedding plants, but you want to make them as good as possible for pollinators. So Julia, if you just press next, you should see, you just see, for example, here will tell you what to plant in springtime, what plant it is, whether it's an annual or perennial, and the flowering period. So you can get a good idea so that your planting schemes all look as good as they can right throughout the year. Next, please, Julia. And then, yes, just on the back of that same list, there's an even longer list for summer planting ideas. And next, Julia, please. And here's just, again, zooming in, you can see a huge list of plants. And so it really shows you, though, that there's no reason not to plant for pollinators because there are so many plants out there which will benefit our bees and butterflies and other insects. Next, Julia. And just another example, then, is the ponds for dragonflies. And if you just press next. And you'll just see here, for example, this will show you how to make a fantastic garden pond, which will be good for dragonflies, frogs, and lots of other insects as well. So really some different things out there. Next. Yeah. And so you'll find those if you go onto the Keep Scotland Beautiful website. I'll ask Julia to circulate this. But if you're on the website, you can just go to the search function. So Julia, if you just press next, please, you'll see that, the little hand lens there. So if you go to that and it's typing garden for life, and Juliet will show you the next slide then. And so here you'll see in the results down at the bottom there, if Juliet presses next, you'll see it comes up with resources. So if you just click on resources, that's where you'll find all of those leaflets. Now on to wild spaces then. So wild spaces is my main job nowadays. This is what I do. So this is a completely new butterfly conservation initiative. We want to create 100,000 new wild spaces around the UK. And my project is called Wild Spaces Perth and Stirling. It's a completely new project and it's the only one in the UK so far. So these wild spaces are places where butterflies and moths can feed, breed and shelter. So Juliet, if you just press next, please. And these should have nectar-rich plants for the adults, plants for the caterpillars of those species to feed upon, and quiet spaces for them to make their cocoons. So we'll be making guides and things to show you how to provide those all in your green spaces to really help those butterflies and moths. Next, please. And so that could be through things like planting common native trees, things like birch or rowan or hazel are all really good food for moths. So it could be planting some more of those, but also not just clearing the leaves away every year, for example, so not taking the leaves away and burning them or putting them in the compost, leaving some underneath for them to make their cocoons within. And you can be using those and wildflowers in your gardens, parks and public green spaces. So there'll be an element of working in your own garden, but also public green spaces too. So you can do it anywhere. And the next one then, please, Julia. And so just an example of that. So Julia, you might just have to keep up with me on the life cycle of the orange-tipped butterflies. So they come out in springtime. It's a species many people recognize now, the male and female pair. And they'll lay their eggs mostly on a few common wildflowers, but also some in gardens. So Julia, if you just press next, please, you'll see a zoom in. It'll show you then the caterpillar food plant is mostly cuckoo flower, but in our gardens, they'll also come to Honesty, Dame's Violet, and a few other different plants. And you can see the little orange eggs there. And then just next, please, Juliet. So they'll feed for about 6 weeks. And after that, then they will crawl off and make their chrysalis. So this species crawls off to a hard surface. It makes its cocoon or chrysalis, and it will spend the entire winter that way. It spends about 10 months of its life inside that chrysalis. So this is just to illustrate the point that you need the caterpillar plants. The nectar plant is also the caterpillar food plant in this case, and also to provide a quiet space for them to remain for the vast majority of their life if you want to see these orange-tipped butterflies there. So Juliet, just next, please. And just an example from my garden here, I was clearing away some stems from Dame's Violet, also known as Sweet Rocket. And if you just look in the center there, you'll see the chrysalis of an orange tip butterfly. Now, if I had, it just looks like a thorn. If I had cleared that away, you know, put it in the council compost bin or whatever, or burned it or anything like that, then that insect would have been destroyed. So it's just, we'll be talking to people about themes like this. So the project that I mentioned then has started just a few weeks ago, and over the next 2 years we'll be making 30 new wildflower meadows or urban forests in Perth and Stirling. So we're looking for volunteers to help with that. So if you're based in one of those areas, do let us know, and I've got my contact details here. I'll also be running gardening for butterflies and moth workshops, wild space creation workshops that will be outside of Stirling and Perth. So I'll be going around Scotland to different local authority areas, showing you how you can get involved. So I might come and speak to different groups, for example, through Keep Scotland Beautiful, and show you how you can make your own wild spaces. We've also got 400 free trees and wildflower packs to give away in Stirling and Perth. So again, if you're in one of those cities, then let me know. So my contact details are there, and I'll put them in the chat box as well, so that you can get in touch with me after today to find out more about the project. So that's me. That's my final page. So I've got nothing else to say, but just in case anybody needs to jot down my email there, but I will put it in the chat so that you can get it from there as well. Thanks.
Great. Thank you so much, Anthony. And yeah, thank you for the reminder of the Garden for Life free resources. And like Anthony said, they're easy to download. And if you're going out to events or you want to take them to things you're doing, you can print them off as well. Yeah, and it's really exciting to hear about your Wild Spaces project. So I hope lots of the audience and our groups get in touch with you to join in. So thank you very much.
No, thanks for that.
Okay, next up we're on to our inspiring case studies from some of our groups. We've asked a number of groups to come and share what they've been achieving recently. So first up we have Janet MacArthur from Friends of Starbank Park in Edinburgh to share the work they've been doing with young people through the Duke of Edinburgh Award. I was really lucky to go visit the garden this year, and I got to meet some of the young people there too. So yeah, Janet, are you there? I think she's there. Are you able to unmute Janet? Hello, Janet. Do you want to speak? You look like you're not on mute, so we should be able to hear you. Hello, Janet. Okay, well, what I'll do is I will play the video. This one's sound is a bit, it's more funny than the ones we've played already, so you might have to turn the sound up and down a bit, and then hopefully we can come back to Janet after that.
Lovely shade loving plants here. So we saw the Bonaria and Alexander's Maple, Siberian Bulgos. So we'll just get a spade when we're finished clearing the leaves, and we're going to split it to create more plants. So you just need to plant them at soil level. So they're quite nice leaves. Do you want to have a look at this, Catherine? Because it's a great leaf. It's actually a wee bit.
It's
going to
be a lovely plant, that one.
Do you want me to
split it?
Yes, if you okay. Just feel confident, go for it. And I've also got these glasses. Yeah, just get right in the middle, go down. Oh, great. Fantastic. And I'll give you some bulbs as well to plant in there. Pass these bulbs over. So, we're just putting about three or five bulbs in each hole. We've got some tulips, narcissus and some alliums. We're trying to plant the alliums to keep the squirrels from destroying the tulips. They don't really like garlic very much, so I'll pass them over here. We've got a space, and just go for it and pop in some when you get space. We've got these lovely glasses as well. And what's lovely about this group is it's a real mixture of bronze, silver and some of the parents come along as well to help out, which is absolutely fantastic. So it's good support. Some of our younger volunteers come as well. Natasha. People have been done their bronze, they moved on to silver, and they still want to come back and volunteer here, so that's a good sign. Why did you choose Starbuck Park for volunteering, Grace?
So, originally it's because I live in the area, and my mom and Miss Janet are like pretty good friends, so when the opportunity arose for me to work at a community park where I already do kind of live nearby and visit pretty frequently, I thought it'd be pretty fun to join. And so me and a couple other friends that like live around the vicinity all joined. It's really fun so far. So.
What do you like about gardening here?
I like how like nice and open air this garden is, and I also like how when I like put in the work, I can always see what comes out. Like for example, at the bottom of the park, my friend and I planted a huge like boat full of flowers, and we could see it like growing right now. That's really, it's really nice because I get to see what like comes out from my work.
And have you made any new friends whilst you've been volunteering here?
Yeah, it's been really nice. Like I meet lots of people who actually do live in the area. So like after I know a bunch of people, which is always good. And like when we're doing like the stuff for the community, like face painting, we did a face painting one for cherry blossoms. Me and a girl I never really spoke to before, we hung out and it was really good. I enjoyed it.
And would you recommend doing Duke of Edinburgh to other people?
Yeah, it's a great experience. And like, I probably wouldn't have tried gardening if I hadn't done the DV, because like, I don't have a garden myself really that I take care of very well. But because like, I had the opportunity with DV, it's been really nice. And I've got to learn some skills that I probably wouldn't have acquired earlier.
Excellent. And what are you doing today?
I'm right now like replanting some daisies into kind of smaller pots so that way they can grow better and have some more space to kind of spread out.
So you've been doing the skill for your volunteering, the horticultural skill?
Yes.
Rather than just volunteering?
Because I did volunteering at my school because I had an opportunity to, but I didn't have a skill, so I decided to use the gardening as my skill rather than a volunteering.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for all your hard work, Grace. Very much appreciated.
Thank you.
Sophia, what are you doing today?
I'm planting calendula.
Oh, and they're beautiful flowers on them, aren't they?
Yeah, it's really pretty. And
yeah.
Growing.
And it's such a good plant for you. So many different benefits.
Yeah.
It can be teas and creams. Fantastic plant. Thank you for potting them on. Hi, Henry. What are you doing today?
So we're moving soil onto the beds.
Alright, so it was all the mulch from the compost you made last year?
The compost we made last year.
And what do you enjoy most about working here at Starbuck Park?
I enjoy the new things I learned. I like a lot about gardening, new skills.
You made new friends?
Yeah,
I'm
making new friends.
Yeah. And do you like being outdoors even in the...
Yeah, come break, I'm shy. It's always fun.
Oh well, thank you very much for volunteering here. We're making the soil for next year, basically the compost for next year. And do you like volunteering here at Starbuck?
Yeah, it's really good.
Yeah, we really like it.
And why did you choose Starbuck of all the places?
Well, it's very near where I live, and I grew up like in the park, so.
No. Been to all our community events.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's good fun though, isn't it?
Yeah, it's really good.
Well, thank you very much for volunteering here, and you as well, Natalia. So I appreciate you coming on and helping out. It's great stuff. Thank you. Hi, ladies. What are you doing today?
Hi, we're making wreath bundles for the park.
Excellent. There's lots of different foliage in there, so that's great.
Yes.
Fantastic. Making a good job of that. Thank you very much.
Starbuck Park is great for volunteering.
Janet, are you If you speak, do you think we can hear you? I can see you. I can see you're here. But do you want to try speaking? No. Janet was just going to share some top tips of working through with young people through the Duke of Edinburgh Award, but I think we're having a bit of technical issue, unfortunately. One sec. I will pull them up. Anyway, here's some top tips that Janet had sent in. So it's about creating a fun and relaxed environment, having a single point of contact, having a large group of support volunteers who all need to be PVG checked, creating a structure and a plan session, but be willing to adapt that depending on who you're working with, and being kind and supportive of the young people. Be firm, but also be fair. And yeah, as you do with all ages of volunteers, make sure to reward them for the work they're doing and get them involved in the community events, because like the volunteers at Friends of Starbank Park, you can see how much fun they're having. Janet, maybe we'll be able to get your sound during the Q&A session. But yeah, sorry, it's not worked. But if anyone wants to ask Janet anything through email, they can send that through to me if we can't get your sound back. So thank you so much for sending everything in. And it's fantastic to see how well your group works with young people through Duke of Edinburgh, and what a positive experience it is for them and for the rest of the group. So thank you very much for that. Our next inspiring case study is from Riverside Naturally in Stirling. So welcome to Mary and Emily, who I hope are there.
Hi. Hello. Can you hear us?
Hello.
Okay?
We can, yes. So I'll just move it to your first slide. So over to you.
Good afternoon. Well, I am Emily, and next to me is Mary, and I will be speaking for the people of Riverside Naturally, and Mary will be speaking for the plants of Riverside Naturally. So briefly, we came into imagination in 2018, where the beautiful red oak that you can see in this picture was felled, and this inspired a group of Riversiders and the community orchard group to band together and form a group, local volunteers, who tried to make Riverside a better place for people by making it a better place for nature. Next slide. So we have been part of, as it says, It's Your Neighbourhood since 2019, and we've really enjoyed working towards the three pillars. It's really allowed us to kind of consolidate our decision-making process, which, because we're all quite chatty, can sometimes take a wee while, and also just give us a focus for our objectives too, which we're just about, we'll go through briefly. With Mary next, but also this is us with our assessor this year, the wonderful Mo. So we just really liked and wanted to share it with you. So next slide, please.
Thank you. Under the heading of garden achievement, we just wanted to briefly highlight some of the work we do in three of the areas that we look after in Riverside. These areas all run alongside a really well-used footpath, which runs from a lovely little bridge that goes over into Campus Kenneth, along the meanders of the River Forth, and then right up to our small but well-established community orchard in Riverside. So we're in real public view in this area. The slides there are showing a bit of progression of one of the beds, our story garden. But we have a woodland garden and a story garden, which were originally quite large beds that the council looked after, that maintenance kind of dwindled away, and they became just really overcrowded, dark, uninvited spaces, full of, you know, overcrowded trees and shrubs, very compact ground, and really nothing much was growing there, and there was very little life. We took over Woodland Garden in 2020. And the council came along, and in consultation with us, we cut down some of the dead and diseased trees, removed a lot of those overgrown shrubs, and we let the light flood into the area. We put down compost and bark mulch, and then went into, you know, a fair bit of research into what sort of plants would traditionally be grown in a woodland area, as we were really quite strict with what we planted at that time. Now, that area has become a beautiful, lush area that really does look like a woodland, and it looks like it's been there for a long time. We have since then had a lovely bark path installed, and we have a wood sculpture of an otter from one of the old tree trunks that has been made, and we have a path leading through the garden up to that sculpture, and that actually mirrors the otters that are we see regularly swimming in the river Forth just across the path from us. The path also allows people to be invited into the garden and to look around, but not to tread on the plant. That's been really successful, and it's been a really beautiful area. And now just 2 years later, it really does look quite lush and an area to be proud of for us. The following year, just last year, 2021, we took over the second of these beds, and that has morphed into our story garden. And those are actually some photographs there on that slide, where the first one is actually showing after the trees and shrubs had been cleared and we had done some bark mulch. The next one shows some of the planting that has gone in since then. And we, in the distance, you can't really see well, we have a willow arbour, a living willow arbour that we've made, and that is filled with tiny little wooden sticks, which a lot of the local children will sit on and hear stories and have story time in there. And those tree trunk seats actually came from felled trees that the council then chopped up for us and made into seats. We also used all the dead trees of our own sort of mulch and bark. So we've used that along to mulch that area. And that has also been planted with native plants, but we've been a bit more relaxed on our choice of plants in this area. And so we also include plants that are more commonly found in gardens and maybe cottage type planting, so that people can really recognise things that are grown in their own garden and say, I see that and I have some sort of relationship with it, but also see that they can make a wildlife area in their own gardens. And that's really important for us to be able to communicate that type of thing and to let people see that that perception of what might be a beautiful plant or something that they might think of as a weed is actually really beneficial in terms of beauty and for the local pollinators and local wildlife. In this area, we also have stumpy, which we've just started, and we have just put in a bee bank, which is a very exciting project, where we have made an area that we hope that mining bees will inhabit next season, and we're doing some planting there so that we've got pollen-rich plants which encourage them to come in there. And again, that's something that we want other people to be able to see in operation and something that they might put into their own gardens. With an awful lot of these projects, we also are able to source a stand for a bee bank locally from somebody who was getting rid of an old clay pit. So as much as we can, we get things from the local community and we encourage people to help us with the planting. And they also donate plants, so people give us things from their gardens so that they have that real relationship with the area, because they can see something that they've actually placed in the garden. I could talk for hours on this, but I shall move on. If I could have the next slide, please, Juliet, that would be great. And we shall move on to environmental responsibility, but also our wildflower area, which is an area that we have really, I think, illustrates the fact that we make plans, they don't work out, we change them, we discuss things with each other, and we learn from our mistakes. So in that area up by our orchard, we had originally made plans to do the traditional stripping of the turf, so in a big, really a wildflower meadow. That changed, and COVID kind of helped us to sort of change our plans because we just weren't able to put that into place. And through looking at what we actually had the ability to do, we started to put some pod plants, some sort of low-growing native plants, into some of our grassland areas, which was moderately successful, but really made us stop in our tracks and reassess what we were doing. So we looked at changing those plants, and we have ended up now with a species-rich grassland in that area. we have installed a really deliberate mowing regime around that area so that we have that. And we have planted with larger plants rather than plugs, we've got larger plants. And we have things planted in there like self-heal, knapweed, field scabious, horsefoot trefoil, and it has become an area that we have allowed some of the local children helped us to plant, and we are just going to watch how that evolves. It has also helped us to really fix our planning and our thinking and our rationale behind the decision making, because we had to go to our funders and say we've changed our plans and get their agreement, and now we're off. So everything is a success, but we change according to the sort of dynamics of the people we have working with us, and whatever the weather and these viruses throw at us. Environmental responsibility is incredibly important to us, and so we have various projects on the go. We compost. We also have like a bee bed planted up in. We have the Butterfly Conservation Trust and the On the Verge organisations helped us with that. So we show where we can have a really good show of plants, but they are perennials, they're repeat free, they're pesticide free, but people can see how they can have a really good show all year that encourages pollinators into the area, and that they can take away those ideas and use them in their own gardens. We also have areas up at our compost heap where we have had twigs, etc., lying about, and then they've been grown over by cleavers and nettles and things like that, and they've become homes to local insect populations. So now they are adopted into our way of life and our gardening, becoming cleaver's cottage and nettle nook and that type of thing. We always get as much as we possibly can to reuse in the area and from the local community. And we have lots of signs up explaining the rationale behind what we're doing, how, why we plant, the way that we plant, and what our long-term goals are for the area. So, environmental responsibility is incredibly important for us all. We also have an area that is not up at the river there, which is totally separate, and it's called an ARC, which is short for restorative kindness, and it's part of the wearetheart.org organisation, and that is completely wild. So it's allowed to be bramble, full of brambles and full of native planting. We are very hands-off in maintenance, really just watching out for any invasive species coming along, and the only thing we've really planted are some locally sourced oak saplings. And we do that in collaboration with the local council living us. So that is a completely wild area, which has been really great for the local environment. We've lost a lot of that type of habitat, the building project. And so that's another project that we're incredibly keen on and really proud of sharing with other people. And I will now hand you on to the next slide, please.
So community participation and engagement is something that is the heart of everything we do in Riverside Naturally. As a result, we've done collaborations with the Riverbank Centre and the Riverside Primary School for bird boxes around the river. We've helped the primary school with their big planters. We've made, and with the primary ones, we named our otter Alice in her woodland wonderland. We've taken walks with the primary school children, brought them down during COPs 16 down to the orchard. One of them lost a shoe in a grass pile. It was chaos. An amazing fun. We've had walks with the Stirling School of English, introducing people from the greater community into Riverside, because we're just a very small part of Stirling. We've had working with the university, we've trialed hedgehog surveys, because it turns out everyone loves hedgehogs. We've hosted events. We do our Orchard Day every year, where we juice local produce from all around our area. We've done the seed swap, which has allowed people to share all sorts of things within the garden, and they've allowed us to have some of their things to put, as Mary said, to offer a connection to the green spaces in their area. And in addition, what we offer to our community is an opportunity to talk with us. We have signs every time we're working saying, ask us what we're working on. We instigated breaks, formal breaks, when we would sit and invite people, whether they were reading with us or not, just to come and have a chat and get the opportunity to find out what we're doing. Because sometimes people don't necessarily understand what we're doing. When we started our long our wildflower meadow, having long grass was just completely unsightly. Why are you neglecting this space? And it gave us the opportunity to say, there is a reason for it. Come along with us and understand why we're doing this. And also to say, well, we're not actually going to change. We're not actually going to change what we're doing, but maybe we can enhance it. Maybe we can add paths. Maybe we can teach you, inform you a bit better. So everything we do, we want to bring our community with us and also, allow that chat, give ourselves a chance to explain what we're doing and why we're doing it. Because we do really want to build a community that's not just us weeding our spaces, but saying, come on, this is for you, that you can be part of this too. So community participation and engagement is very, very important, as are our volunteers, because our volunteers are the people that do it. They're the people that have the ideas, they're the people who make these things happen. Without them, we would just be sitting, drinking coffee, making plans. And it is very, very important that everyone feels valued and wants to keep coming along. So what we've done is really given our volunteers the opportunity to explore their projects and their passions. And the arc is how we got Mary. You know, Mary was really keen to do it. So she came along and we said, yeah, sounds great. The bee bank was another passion project. The willow arbor was someone who spotted that nothing was growing in a space. So what could we do? We'll build a arbor. So we did that just during Storm Arwen, which wasn't such a great idea, but it's still standing. So that's great. So it's just, for us, empowering our volunteers is a way to keep them coming back and feeling attached and connected to our spaces. And I hope, like me, they're really proud of what they're doing. So, yeah, so that's what we feel about our volunteers. Mm. Yep, that's you. Your turn.
Thank you. And here we are, coming to the end here with our growing season slide. Maintaining green spaces and community interest is really our going forward. We had said that it's really not about exciting new projects, because we really have to nurture and maintain our existing projects, and whilst also keeping interest and engagement from everybody in the local community. So we're really looking towards that. However,
as we're watching,
Anthony McCoskey, immediately we're both going to get in touch with him about this. So that might be another project we will be looking at, because we are going to be looking at next year about mapping green spaces. One of our trustees is looking at mapping wildlife areas, bug hotels, etc., in the gardens of Riverside, and seeing whether we can build up a picture of that. And so we would also be really interested in getting in touch with Anthony about the Wild Spaces project too. So there we go, we're taking on no new projects.
No new projects.
Now we're excited about another project.
We're empowering each other. On a more practical note, we need to keep reaching out, keep getting, there's 10 to 13 of us really that regularly come along, so getting more people involved practically, and also learning about what we're doing and hopefully being inspired is really, really important. And also, on a very practical note, we just need to be better at telling people what we're up to.
Absolutely. So anyway, just to end, thank you very much to the lecturer, Mo, and everybody, and everyone who has spoken today.
Sorry, can't hear you very well. I think it's just that's better.
Is that better? Thank you.
Yeah.
And so just a final thank you to Julia, to our technical, and everybody on the neighbourhood for inviting us, just to give you a small flavour of all of the things that are going on with Riverside naturally. And so please, if you're visiting Stirling, please do feel free to come and visit us and get in touch with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary and Emily. It's fascinating, and I feel that we maybe have to get you back for one of our online Q&A sessions so we can dedicate the session so people could find out more. But yeah, so much to learn. But yeah, please do get in touch with Anthony. That'd be great. Thank you. Okay, our next inspiring case study is from Scott Shanks from York Hill Green Spaces. He's going to tell us how they are making room for biodiversity and going to share some hints and tips. So over to you, Scott, if you're there.
Hello, everyone. Thanks very much, Juliet. My name's Scott, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about the work of York Hill Green Spaces in Glasgow. And while it's making space for biodiversity, I am going to focus quite a lot on pollinators, which kind of fits with the sort of plantee sort of scheme. So a lot of it will be in there. Could you move on to the next slide, please? So York Hill Green Spaces formed in 2017. And I guess the original remit was to improve just two of our local parks in Glasgow for people, really, was kind of, I think, the major focus and the local sort of community. And over time, shortly after I joined, the move to look at biodiversity and wildlife was kind of like sort of brought in and enhanced quite a bit. So go on to the next slide. Thank you. So this shows just the location of our three parks. So York Hill's very, very close to the city centre in Glasgow and quite close to the Kelvin Grove Park, if anyone knows, and that in Glasgow University. So we have three major parks that we now look after as part of York Hill Green Spaces. We have Over Newton Park, which is a traditional, quite formal park with nice gardens and kind of planters. We've got Cherry Park, which is quite a small, again, quite formal park with lots of sort of cherry trees, as the name suggests. And also York Hill Park, which is quite close to the River Kelvin and the River Clyde, and is much more wild. It's got a lot more biodiversity in it, and takes a lot more activity to maintain. If you go on to the next slide, please. So one of the things that we've kind of looked at in the last couple of years when we've been looking at how we can enhance the parks for biodiversity and for the people is really an assessment of what do pollinators really need when we're trying to provide things. So firstly, obviously, pollinators, they need flower-rich habitats, so lots of wild flowers, but also sort of herbaceous perennials and kind of trees as well provide lots of flowers. But also having a look at what other stage of the life cycle of those pollinators might need. So a lovely butterfly. So Anthony's a fantastic talk about the wild spaces. We've had a look at caterpillar food plants, but also places where hoverflies might nest or bumblebees might nest. So trying to provide those kind of habitats as well. So we've had a look at providing places for them to breed, so lots of dead woods, warm sheltered areas for butterflies to live in. We've tried to reduce the impact of kind of strong streetlights and LED sort of lights that have been sort of going in through the city. We've tried to minimize those in important areas where possible. We've done a lot to try and connect up our different parks, so trying to improve some of the streets and different members of York Hill Green Spaces planting up their own gardens and window boxes and doing things to try and connect our parks together has been a really lovely sort of thing that we've done. We've tried to ensure that we aren't too tidy in the winter, so leaving those kind of leaves on the kind of flower beds and kind of under the sort of hedging, so lots of places for ladybirds and kind of butterflies to sort of a overwinter. And obviously we haven't been using any pesticides sitting there. But one of the other things we've tried to do is try to look at sustainability as well. So whenever we've done kind of sort of planting, we've not used peat, so we've gone peat free for I think it's probably 3 or 4 years now. We've been peat free and tried a wide variety of different sort of growing mediums. If we go on to the next slide, please. Yes, so one of the key things, obviously, for gardening is looking at, and particularly for pollinators, is looking at providing nectar and pollen all the way through the year. And the really important parts of the year, obviously, in spring, when there's much less in the way of kind of diversity of kind of lovely herbaceous perennials out, And then in the autumn, when bumblebee queens and butterflies are trying to feed up and get nice and fat before they hibernate. So what we've kind of looked at is to try and provide things like spring bulbs, ensure that spring bulb sort of planting has been hugely successful. So we have literally put in thousands of spring bulbs over the last 3-4 years. And things like crocuses are really, really good. Snake's head fritillaries, winter aconites, and things like grape hyacinth, super easy, very, very, like fairly cheap to sort of buy in bulk as well. And going, one thing would be avoid daffodils, really. We've kind of found that daffodils are terrible for bumblebees and hoverflies. They don't really provide much in the way of nectar. Lovely bright color, but unfortunately crocus is much, much better. Could you go on to the next slide, please? So not just in the spring. So what we've tried to do in particularly the more formal areas, so in Over Newton Park, we've got a sensory garden and quite a few sort of beds. And in there, we've tried to plant with as many good nectar sort of rich and pollinator friendly sort of plants as possible. So some of those are wild and native sort of plants, things like red campion, just flower, like such a long sort of flowering season. Things like white dead nettle or white lamium, super for bumblebees, and a lovely little iridescent leaf beetles that kind of feed on them as well. But a granny's bonnets and things like perennial sort of wallflower are just fantastic for these areas. And as I said earlier, we all of our planters are planted up with peat-free sort of compost. And we have tried a variety of different varieties, some maybe a bit more drier and kind of and needing a bit more kind of water and maintenance than others, but all of them have been fantastic. We've had really good sort of results from all of our peat-free compost. On to the next slide, please. So one of the great things to do at this time of year, as well as planting up the crocuses and the spring bulbs, is putting in a hedge for pollinators and for other wildlife. So we've been just in the last week, we've been putting in more pollinator sort of hedges in Cherry Park, but we've put in hedges in Over Newton Park, and last year lots of pollinator hedging in York Hill Park as well. So that'll be things like hawthorn and elderflower, plants interspaced with things like honeysuckle, dog roses scrambling through. So there's flowers and there's berries and there's all sorts of kind of, sort of lovely nooks and crannies for wildlife to sort of be in. And it's beautiful too, just the smell of the hawthorn and the blackthorn and things like the honeysuckle is just a wonderful place to sort of walk past. Next slide. So not forgetting trees. So I think trees you often think of like for birds and for sort of for other wildlife to sort of be in, but actually trees are really good for pollinators as well, particularly in the spring. So lots of our fruit trees, plums, apples, the blossom is they just produce a huge amount of blossom, really good for sort of bees. But things like sallows, our willows and sallows, the little catkins there, little things like solitary bees and a bumblebees. It's willow catkins are really, really important. One of the things that I found just in the last 2 years, which I didn't realize, is I don't know if you'll be able to see on the wild cherry slide, those just at the very base of wild cherry leaves, they've got two little red nectary sort of things. So they actually produce a little bit of sweet nectar at the base of their sort of leaves, and that attracts in things like wasps that will then defend the plant and look for caterpillars and anything that's kind of feeding on them. So that's a little iridescent ruby-tailed wasp feeding on the little pink nectaries at the base of a leaf. If you go on to the next slide. Slow motion animation. This is one of the team of volunteers that came and helped plant. I think we had 250 trees that we put in to York Hill Park late last year. And that was to replace, I think there was about 30 trees that were felled as part of path maintenance work, which we were slightly annoyed about at the time, but actually the opportunity to put in a lot more pollinator friendly and native trees was actually really good as well. On to the next slide, please. Some of the really successful and popular things that we've done are putting in these wildflower strips. So we've put them in a number of places. These are quite small, mini wildflower meadows. So the very first one we put in, I think, is 20 meters long and it's about a metre and a half sort of wide. And we made it by taking off the turf, and which is quite a hard job for a small gang of volunteers on the days there, piling the turf up as a kind of beetle bank and as a kind of wildlife kind of set of bank feature was great. And then we sowed with a combination of a cornfield annual wildflowers, so that's things like the poppies and the cornflower and the corn marigold and the lovely scentless mayweed, but also lots of native perennials in there. So if you go on to the next slide. So that just shows things like the a tufted vetch and the beautiful oxeye daisies and red campions that have come up. And so that first year of yellow, white and blue is spectacular, but it's been replaced by, you know, sort of rich pinks and yellows and sort of whites and kind of and following years. And it's really easy to maintain. Just let it grow in the spring, and we cut it back just once in the autumn, take all the arisings off and put them into the sort of compost bin. And it's absolutely buzzing with pollinators, and people absolutely love them as well. Next slide, please. So one of our biggest challenges was taking on the management of about 1 hectare of wildflower meadow of, well, what was amenity grassland in York Hill Park. And these were on the slopes of York Hill Park. For about 10 years, it had been, at least 10 years, it had been managed with a cut every year. And then about 5-6 years ago, it was completely abandoned and the council stopped cutting it. So it was incredibly rank, dense, a sort of thick grasses, very few flowers actually in there. And what we wanted to do is improve that for pollinators. So one of the first things we did when we got a sign off from council to manage it was we had it cut. We cut 75% of it, got volunteers to rake it off. So that's what the volunteers are doing there. They're kind of sort of raking off the sort of grass and piling it under a set of trees as kind of, sort of habitat piles. Interestingly, while we were sort of doing that, the council were also improving one of the paths that are going in, so one of the steps there, and the diggers and excavators that were going up and down actually stripped all the grass off next to the steps. And we used that as a great opportunity to sow an area of wildflowers as well. So it's about 120 meters square of bare ground that was left. And we sowed that with around 40 species of wildflowers. And this just shows, I think if you push the next, the plug plants were one of the things that we did this year and last year. So we've put in 2,800 plug plants into York Hill Park to try and improve the biodiversity in there, and also allowing things like orchids and native flowers to come through as well. And this is what the area that we sowed next to the steps looks like in the first year. And this last year passed, it's been all of the perennials have come through and looking absolutely amazing. On to the next slide, please. So there's a couple of key issues. If you're taking on management of a wildflower meadow, really one of the key things, if you were in the suburbs or you were kind of close to the edge of the city, you might be able to get a farmer to come in and maybe cut your meadow, and who would maybe want that grass and take it away as kind of silage or as a kind of hay crop. In an urban inner city park, it's really difficult because you've got so much litter coming in. There's a picture of toilets that were thrown onto our meadow at the top, which is terrible. But dog mess and sort of things like that. So it's really hard to get that grass off. So finding a place that we can put the kind of the cut grass where it's not going to have an impact was really important. So we found that under the hedging and under areas of trees, we're able to rake up the grass, put it under there, and it rots down like very, very fast and into the leaf litter, and actually, so it benefits the trees as well. One of the initial things, if you're converting amenity grassland into wildflower meadow, you could actually have problems with high nutrients in there. So because we didn't strip off the turf, there's a lot of high nutrients in the soil. So things like nettles, thistles can kind of sort of come through. Still great for pollinators, great for a whole range of wildlife. But when you're trying to kind of sort of showcase it and encourage everyone that a lovely wildflower meadow is a good thing, having lots of thistles is maybe not the best in the very first year. So we've been quite lucky in not getting too many patches of nettles and sort of things. However, the one really nice patch of nettles that we did have in the sunshine absolutely covered in peacock butterfly and small tortoiseshell caterpillar, a butterfly caterpillars this year, which was absolutely amazing. And everyone absolutely loved seeing that. So even with the nettles and thistles, it turned out really well. One of the other things we did there is we sowed yellow rattle last winter. So this is this vampiric plant, great for bees, absolutely love hoverflies and bees, absolutely love it. But it latches into the roots of grass, also things like clover and other things as well. And that just reduces the vigor of the grass, allows other wildflowers to come through. And we had an amazing success story with sowing. Yeah, I think we spent about £100 on yellow rattle seed last year for 1 hectare, which was pretty thinly sowed. And this year it was spectacular. It was really beautiful. So next slide. One of the things that we obviously want to do, so if you've got butterflies and bees flying past, you really want to hold on to them and make them stay and breed in the park as well. So putting in as many pollinator-friendly plants as possible. And so Anthony mentioned orange tip and cuckoo flower, and so planting plug plants of cuckoo flower, making sure that we've got bare ground for little solitary bees, and so we've got funding to make bee banks this year as well. Putting up bee hotels for little things like red mason bees and leafcutter bees. And we've got some fantastic standing deadwood trees that we've left in situ, and they're absolutely full of amazing little pollinating wasps and little solitary wasps, which are really good for the environment as well. The last few weeks here, we've put in a series of bog gardens in York Hill Park, which allows us, we've very few wetland features and standing water, so that's been really good for them as well. Next slide. One of the really lovely things that has kind of happened just since lockdown, really, since 2020, we started recording the species that we found. So we go out every 2 weeks and have an event. And while we do that, we spend 10 minutes or so looking for wee beasties that we can find or birds that might fly past. And we write this up every month. At the start of the month, we send out what we'd seen in the last month and update our species list. So we're currently on 1,190 species. And we had a fantastic community event to try and find our 1,000th species. Lots of kids with bug pots and running around trying to find something new and exciting, which was wonderful. Of that, we've probably got at least 400 pollinators sitting in there, like bees, wasps, butterflies, and moths and little flies, but so many more to find, lots and lots of other things to find. And we try to encourage whenever there's the big butterfly count or a city nature challenge or various other kind of big a BioBlitz types of events, we try and encourage lots of our members to go out and do that. And the maps down at the corner there are little dots on the map for people using the iNaturalist app, which is one of these fantastic apps that identify things for you. And we can actually see all the records that have popped up on our parks, which is absolutely lovely. And we encourage everyone to go to our parks and use the app and collect lots of records for us. The two photos there are just photos of some of the moths and some of the bees that we found in York Hill. On to the next slide. And yeah, just a huge thank you to all of our volunteers that have come along in snow and rain and sunshine. The funders that we've got, it's been lovely to get funding from some of our local supermarkets and from Nature Scot and KSB as part of our kind of sort of prizes as well. And thank you everyone for taking part and sort of coming along. And I should say we're super, super proud of our Green Flag Award that we have got for the last couple of years. And our Pollinator Award that we got last year is one of our absolute highlights. Anyway, I shall stop there. Thanks everyone for listening.
Thank you, Scott. Yeah, your group's doing so much for biodiversity in York Hill. And I've definitely gone away with some good advice and tips, and I'm sure everyone else will be as well. So thank you very much. Okay, our last inspiring case study, the Satutery, started in 2015. It's been created by an informal group of volunteers coordinated by David Carruthers, a local shopkeeper in West Ross in the village of Gairloch. And I'm going to hand you over now to David to tell the story. So David, are you there?
Thanks very much, Juliet. Hello, everyone. The Satutery Wildlife Observation Garden is a very narrow strip of roadside verge separating the road towards the pier in Gairloch from the very edge of the sea. There is an abundance of wildlife in the area, including dolphins, otters, and sea eagles. Stunning scenery surrounds this most beautiful seaside village in Westeros. Well, it was beautiful until rampant invasive gorse, several feet high, overwhelmed the verges alongside the Pier Road area, blocking out the lochside view and even making wheelchair access down the roadside pavement very difficult. Pressure on the local council in 2014 resulted in the gorse being hacked down to a lower level. At last, we had our magnificent panoramic views of the loch restored, but the mess left behind was devastating. Rubbish, litter, and other pollution were revealed left behind in the gorse. As a village shopkeeper on Pier Road, with the Situtary area being directly opposite, I'm in the most privileged position to hear the community's ideas, hopes, and aspirations. Every local who came into the shop complained bitterly about the scene of devastation left behind by the council. The crunch came when one local said, "This is supposed to be the leisure end of the village, and there is not one seat to be had the whole length of Pier Road." I decided to take action and start a wee collection box to raise sufficient money to clear a small area amidst the gorse for, quite simply, a bench. 3 months later, a digger moved in to create a 3 meter square area for the bench. Intense community interest immediately followed, and two benches, a huge planted tub, and several smaller planters were immediately donated the same day, creating an instant pop-up garden. Everyone said, "Wow, where is the next one going to be?" And so this simple development has since grown arms and legs over the years, with the community totally embracing it. From its humble beginnings, the support for the Situtary has transformed a gorse-strewn wasteland into a 206-meter-long, stunning garden. 6 years it has taken to transform the garden, and there is still a lot to develop. Every meter had to be constructed using a digger, as the gorse stumps couldn't be removed by hand. A number of disabled access areas have been created, but construction of the Situtary has been quite an expensive operation. It's been a long uphill battle to raise funds for the further development of the garden, but the huge generosity has been shown by the local community and businesses, and donation boxes on site have raised over £5,000 given by visitors willing to show their appreciation of the garden. And there have been many kind acts of generosity. For example, in the early days, a couple from Cumbernauld sat at a bench watching me riddle some very poor soil. The man said to me, "What you need is some decent topsoil for that." I replied, "Try finding some decent topsoil in Westeros." A few weeks later, he appeared in the shop and called me out to his car. His back seat was full of holiday gear and suitcases. He then opened his boot, and in it were 10 large bags of soil improver as his gift to the garden. During lockdown, the Situtary was of great benefit to the community. It became a popular place to meet up, as it was easy to practice social distancing with loads of fresh air. In fact, it was early in lockdown that there was a team planting session, putting in summer bedding. Normally we have a group planting session, but it was decided to have an hourly rota session for our volunteers. Unfortunately, this went spectacularly wrong when no one wanted to leave at the end of their shift. "But we haven't finished yet," was the protest, and they refused to leave. And so a rapid change of plan was made for new rota arrivals to start on a separate section, so keeping everyone happy. Two recent happenings at the Situtary are well worth a mention. Last summer, we witnessed an engagement between a young couple take place in the garden. How do we know it was an engagement? Well, going down on one knee and presenting his girlfriend with a ring is a bit of a clue. The young man then went to his car, brought out a hamper, laid a tablecloth on the picnic bench, added flute glasses and champagne, and an exotic picnic followed. It's very moving that our wee garden provided the venue that would so change a young couple's lives. Totally different was the situation a volunteer experienced whilst on a deadheading mission. A tourist coach parked nearby, and the garden was descended upon by all its passengers. The volunteer asked the driver what was going on, and he replied that the Situtui was a new addition to his company's Highlights of the Highlands itinerary, an amazing accolade. The Situtui enjoys numerous five-star ratings on TripAdvisor. Last year, our assessor, John McLennan, recommended that we should consider providing a regular update on the group's activities on social media. One of our team took this on board, and his weekly Gerloch Situtui report has become a runaway success with over 1,200 followers. The gardening on the edge is not always a bed of roses. We have, of course, the weather to contend with. The Situtui has very little shelter, and salty sea spray often gets whipped up by the prevailing winds. Plant selection is very important. What do we choose? Well, dwarf or small narcissi and tulips to cope with the high winds. Crocus, we have planted 2,250 just recently, along with iris, grape hyacinth, alliums, and the usual pansies, violas, and primulas, all providing colour in the early spring. Summer bedding plants include gazanias, begonias, bacopa, geraniums, both trailing and upright, fuchsias, argyranthemum, osteospermum, and nemesia. Star dahlias cope well with the wet weather, and several dwarf buddleias are thriving, with one large mature buddleia a couple of years ago attracting thousands of migrating painted lady butterflies over a three-day period. And aeoniums, planted in large terracotta pots, provide extra summer interest. But it is the power of the sea itself that puts the garden most at risk. This was a scene on the seafront at the other end of the village during a storm last year. This area has a sea wall to protect it. Pier Road has no such protection. Fortunately, for once, the Situtui had some shelter from this storm, but it was a close call. 2020 started with a disaster. In January, Storm Brendan, with its huge tidal surge, savaged part of the garden. Benches, picnic tables, and planters were swept away by the waves. All were fortunately rescued by a local man who donned his wetsuit, swam out with a rope, and then pulled each item back to shore. In the next 2 days, hundreds of pounds were donated to repair the damage, which fortunately was relatively superficial once all the mess was cleared away. So why do we garden on the edge? Why did we choose such a vulnerable and exposed area to site a garden? Well, quite simply, it was never intended to be a garden, just a place to sit out to enjoy the fabulous views. But it was the will, the encouragement, and the hard work of the community that has transformed this previous waste of space into a stunning garden enjoyed by tens of thousands of visitors every year. It remains very special and hugely used and appreciated by locals. That is what makes gardening on the edge so worthwhile. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, David. That's another incredibly positive, inspiring story. And I think we all may be visiting your garden next year and the wonderful community garden on the edge. So thank you for coming and sharing the story with us.
Thank you.
Okay, we're running quite over time, but I'm really keen. I know that everyone has lots of questions. So we'll have a bit of time for questions. I'm gonna take down the slides just now so we can see each other. And I'm going to stop sharing and hopefully everyone's still here. My colleague Lisa is going to keep an eye out for hands and I'll have a look as well. So we may not have all the speakers still with us, but if you've got a question that you'd like to ask, just either press your raise hand button or if your camera's on, wave your hand and we'll try and find you. Surely someone out there has a question they would like to ask one of the speakers. And if I'm not seeing you, please unmute and ask your question. Is there anything in there? No, no questions? Oh, Susan. Susan Wilson, do you want to unmute and ask your question? You're on mute just now. Oh, there we go.
Okay. Yeah. I would maybe quite like to go and visit York Hill.
Very close to you.
If I could, because we are based in Easterhouse, so I think it would be nice, you know, if we could arrange something and a couple of us come up for a wee donder.
Still there?
Yeah, I thought it'd be fantastic. I mean, if you're in Easterhouse, pop along. I don't know if you'll get access to the slides. Julia, are you sending around a copy of the slides after?
Yeah, I'll send that around with the recording.
I saw them all, so I did see them.
So the our email address is kind of on there, but also we're on Facebook as well. So if you want to send us a wee message, and one of us will come and give you a look around. We're always happy to sort of share. And it's always good to team up and steal other people's ideas. So, definitely come and see us.
That would be good.
Thanks, Stephen. Terry, got your hand up.
And
you're currently on mute, Terry.
Hi, guys. Sorry, I've got a really dodgy internet connection today. That's why I'm in and out. Juliet, thank you for your patience for my hokey-cokey routine this afternoon. So, it's Christmas, I suppose. Getting into the spirit. No, but I think I really just wanted to back up what Susan's saying there. I found today really inspirational in the sense of, I don't know if it's stars aligning, but a number of things that we're doing here in Fergusley Park are very much in line with what I'm hearing is happening in York Hill, which I'm in that general area every Tuesday, Wednesday, Scott, so be prepared for a chap in the door, my man, and to be equally encouraged that areas like Easterhouse, Fergusley Park, there are many parallels can be drawn. I'm sure there's some real learning curves can be embarked upon there as well. I feel I must address the white elephant in the room. The guy at the beginning with the accent, it just reminded me that we're keeping Scotland beautiful and not just the central belt to detract from York Hill and Easterhouse ever so slightly. It's great to see all these different things going on. And whilst they're all unique and bespoke to each of the communities, they're all really much the same as well. So I've been really inspired. No question as such, but I really think maybe if we all come together in platforms like this, and I'm hoping that the exchange programme that has been spoken about, albeit within a different forum and keeps Scotland beautiful, is something that can be realised in the coming year.
Great. Thank you so much, Terry. John?
Yeah, it's really for Scott once more. And also for the other groups here, I find it very useful to pinch stuff from Scott's page and put it and on my own page. It's a great information source. So it's not really a question, it's more a point to rate his site and get lots of ideas for your own.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, Scott.
Okay. I think just so that you can all have a bit of a comfort break before we move on to the awards, it's just after 10 past. So if I can give you 10 minutes, so 20 past four, to have a bit of a comfort break, grab a cuppa or something sparkly for our award ceremony. And during the comfort break, I'll put on the photo loop as well. So we shall see you all at 20 past four.
Yes, please.
Sorry, I'm just trying to find the photo loop. One second. Sorry, I'm just going to have to close my other one first. Just bear with me a second, I will sort this out. Sorry, technical issues, I apologize. Right, this time it should work. Screen two. Okay, I just have to do one more thing and then I promise you it will be with you this time because I know what I'm doing wrong now. There we go.